This is part two of a House Skepe discussion for Plato's Phaedo, or the Book of Phaedo. I'm Jacob, overseer.
I'm Christy, I'm a scholar.
And I'm Sam, I'm the factotum.
I think last time we were left off was right around the point of where we're starting to get off Frankenstein into Phaedo. So do y'all have any thoughts per se on it?
Well, it just starts off with Phaedo beginning to tell the story of the last days of Socrates and what he said.
It was just an account of Socrates' last days. It's a descriptive title of On the Soul, about his last hours and his death in the jail. Phaedo was an inmate with him there, but he is speaking to, as you say it, Eucrates? Eucrates?
I
think so. Anyway.
One of the things that we touched on last discussion was a lot of the things that we've been reading into has a mixture of both pain and pleasure, both in Frankenstein and at the start of the Plato readings. Do you have any thoughts, since y'all weren't there for the last discussion on that as well, before we start getting in really into it?
I just had a little note that I just put a tag, so it's bittersweet. No man can have pain and pleasure at the same time. So it was like when he discussed, Phaedo was describing, like, you know, how he saw Socrates, and Socrates had, like, a smile on his face, and you know, it seemed as if he's almost happy, so Phaedo had mixed feelings about it. And, that's it.
This goes into, like, Socrates explains why he's happy and not sad, because he tells of, like, what he thinks, kind of, like, what happens after you die, and what he thinks happens. You wouldn't be sad because he believes that he'll go on and live with the gods. So.
Okay. I think we all understood the same thing with that.
Yeah. Let's see.
Because the beginning was easier for me to understand. Mm-hmm. Like I said in class, was that, you know, he's just telling this, you know, basically just the conversation between two men, and he's, you know, kind of giving the precursor to kind of really what happened, and then it picks up later on in the text and starts explaining their actual arguments.
Mm-hmm. I like that. I liked how also in the later, after the first part of the reading that we were supposed to do, that I can't remember who it was, if it was Socrates or... About how they brought up into the fact that, like, your soul and your body are connected as one, and after your body dies, your soul goes off and flies into another body, and therefore your soul lives on in others after you pass away. I think that's what it was. I can't.
Well, before they got into, like, questioning, not really questioning, but giving different points of views against Socrates' point of view, Socrates said at...
Where are you?
67... like, in between D and E. Therefore, as I said at the beginning, it would be ridiculous for a man to train himself in life to live in a state as close to death as possible and then resent it when it comes. And that's him talking about how they should be training for dying and those that do, and how, like, philosophy is kind of training for dying, that they fear death less than men who kind of focus on the physical wants of life.
And the pleasures of the body.
The pleasures, yeah.
It also says in that same, you know, in that tagging along on that same, it says, it is only those who practice philosophy in the right way, we say, who always most want to free the soul. And this release and separation of the soul from the body is the preoccupation of the philosophers. And so he's like, you know, agreeing, so it appears, mm-hmm. that is the truth. But in what I think in this, just this, one tag part is that, how do you know who's practicing philosophy in the right way? And I think that he tries to explain it further in the text of, you know, explaining how to practice philosophy in the right way. But what I don't necessarily know is what's the right way for me might not be the right way for you, mm-hmm. and vice versa. So that part to me is kind of like, well, it's really up to the person's, you know, opinion,
yeah.
or, you know, the judgment.
So the next page around, like 68E and then into 69, he talks about how men, they fear to be deprived of other pleasures which they desire, so they keep away from some pleasures because they are overcome by others. So really they spend their life going from pleasure to pleasure, and that's just how that they live, like that's their cycle of how they live. And then he was saying that it wasn't right and to exchange, well, it says it's not right to exchange pleasures for pleasures, pains for pains, and that you should exchange all of this for wisdom. With this, we have real courage and moderation and justice, and in a word, true virtue with wisdom, whether pleasures and fears and all such things be present or absent.
So I think wisdom is one of those things that's debatable because, you know, like the professor was saying, you know, about wisdom is that you, I confused wisdom with knowledge, and I think that a lot of people do confuse that. I mean, I know for myself, I confuse it because I'm older, you know, and I think that older people than me are wise because of their knowledge. And he's basically not saying that that's not true. And then, obviously, later on in the text, you know, he describes that cycle that you were talking about for the soul.
I agree with that. Like, definitely wisdom and knowledge are two totally different things because you can gain knowledge and gain wisdom through two different ways. I feel like wisdom maybe more is like life experiences that you have to go through at certain thresholds of like ages of life, whereas knowledge can be learned through like a book
mm-hmm.
or just by being taught by a teacher, professor.
Do you think that maturity, though, also plays a part in the wisdom/knowledge?
I feel like that, too.
You think a little bit differently
yeah.
the older you get. I mean,
your brain matures.
Exactly,
more.
Yeah. You, I guess it's the synapses in your brain, you know, goes to different pathways when you're actually thinking about a problem or, you know, problem solving.
So, they're speaking and stuff, and it goes to 70C, and he said, but let us examine it in such a manner at this, whether the souls of men who have died exist in the underworld or not. So now they're going on to focus in their conversation whether or not your soul actually lives on into the underworld.
I had something a little bit further up than that. Was it, it just makes that noise.
Okay.
I'm going to take it to the Apple store. it says, when Socrates finished, Sebes intervened. Socrates, he said, everything else you said is excellent, I think, but men find it very hard to believe what you said about the soul. So this starts their
yeah.
doubt in what he's actually saying. And he further says, they think that after it has left the body, it no longer exists anywhere. I would assume he's speaking of men, maybe just men in general. But that it is destroyed and dissolved on the day that the man dies, as soon as it leaves the body, and that on leaving it, it is dispersed like breath or smoke, has flown away and gone, and is no longer anything anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, so that starts a conversation of whether souls even exist after we die. And one thing that Socrates says is, do not, he said, confine yourself to humanity if you want to understand this more readily. So I think that, and that takes him into the conversation, but I think that's also something that we have to do if we want to try and, like, learn more about what they're talking about, too. So just like Seeds and everyone else in this, like, he's saying don't just confine yourself to what you know now. Like, try and open your mind to understand more of what he was saying. So then he goes in to explain the opposites, and if something has to come from its opposite, so it's saying to something larger has to come from something smaller and vice versa, and that goes into
That was the part that had lost me. I told you that before.
Yeah.
I still don't grasp that too well.
He starts saying, he starts talking about what are, like, certain opposites, like smaller to larger, sleep to awake, and he says, what's the opposite of being alive? And it's dead. And so he says, so what's the opposite of being dead? And that's alive. And so he uses that to help prove himself that it is a cycle, and that not only do you come from somewhere else before you're alive, you also go somewhere else after you die. And that helps him prove that the death, like, I just lost my train of thought, but like after you die, your soul goes somewhere else. And it says right at like 71E, then our souls exist in the underworld. Like, that's him proving his point.
Who is saying that seems likely? Like, he's talking to
Seeds,
but is that Socrates?
No, I think
responding.
So he says, then Seeds, living creatures and things come to be from the dead, and Seeds says, so it appears. He said. So then Socrates says, then our souls exist in the underworld.
And then
Seeb
says,
that
seems
likely.
Okay.
Okay, then down at 72A-ish, it says, it is agreed between us then that the living come from the dead, in this way no less than the dead from the living. And if that is so, it seems to be a sufficient proof that the souls of the dead must be somewhere once they can come back again. So that's pretty much them agreeing on the fact that
they believe that they're coming somewhere.
Yeah.
Coming from somewhere else. But the thing about it is that, you know, you could think about it being like a religious thing too. I mean, because in our times now, you know, people believe different things about religion and whatnot, and that, you know, most Christians believe that, you know, your soul goes to heaven,
mm-hmm.
right? So it's kind of the same thing, except for Socrates thinks of the gods, you know, multiple gods, and Hades, I guess, right?
Yeah.
So it's very similar to what people believe today, and you just have to have that faith, and so he's arguing against that, or arguing for that faith.
On the next page, he uses that to once again confirm his recollection theory or thought about it, that we don't really learn anything new, we just remember what we already knew. And he says, this is possible only if our soul exists somewhere before it took on this human shape. So according to this theory too, the soul is likely to be something immortal. And this is what Socrates said, and this is where Seeds and Simaeus kind of branch off and say, well, wait, we don't know if we believe that. These are our theories. And that's when they go into their their own theories.
Because he says, to know a man is surely a different knowledge from knowing a liar. So he's trying to give an analogy of the harmony and the liar. He's bringing that argument early on.
Then it went, okay, one thing that I was super confused on, and I read it and, reread it, when it was talking about the equal itself, so when it was talking about...
Around 74, right?
Yes, kind of like 73 and 74. It was talking about, if things were equal to each other, and then it spoke of, the equal itself, so, equals capitalized. It was not just, something equal to another, but it was a being, the equal.
I see what you're talking.
Yeah.
He says, consider, he said, whether this is the case. We say that there is something that is equal, so meaning the same.
Yeah.
I do not mean a stick equal to a stick, so two things equal to a stick, or a stone to a stone, or anything of that kind, but something else beyond all of these, which is the equal itself.
Yeah, so they keep going to talk about the equal things and things not being equal. So I kind of took it, I understood it as, and this could be totally wrong, but, the equal is, because this goes along with recollection and everything, have an equal is the thing that we already know and we're comparing things to. So, like, we see one thing and we remember something else. Is the equal, like, the better of the two that we're, comparing it to? Because it says, we must then possess knowledge of the equal before that time when we first saw the equal objects and realized that all these objects strive to be like the equal, but are deficient in this. So it's kind of talking about, like, the equal is always better, and that all the objects that we're seeing are trying to, like, equal it, but it's not. Like,
you think that he's making a reference to balance, that there has to be some type of balance, and, you know, I have two things that are equal, and if you're thinking on a philosophical level, you know, the balance between that there is the equal, therein lies the equal, is the balance?
Maybe.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's just a thought.
Yeah, the equal just really confused me.
But then it goes on to say, you know, talking about the senses, you know, hearing, seeing, perceiving, is like, we must have possessed knowledge of the equal itself if we were about to refer our sense perceptions of equal objects to it.
Yeah.
And realize that all of them were eager to be the light, be like it, but were inferior.
Yeah, so everything that we're seeing is trying to be like something that isn't. Like, that's where I get confused. Like, this little part is just really confusing me about the equal.
And then it goes on to say, we must then have acquired the knowledge of the equal even before this.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, we must have possessed it before birth. So they
so that's
it reaffirms
right, yeah.
more that they agree that the soul has to live
before we're, like, in our human form.
Exactly.
This goes on to the next page, too. But I think if we acquired this knowledge before birth, then lost it at birth, and then later by the use of our senses in connection with those objects we mentioned, we recovered the knowledge we had before, would not what we call learning be the recovery of our own knowledge, and we are right to call this recollection.
I have that same thing.
Yeah. And they said certainly. And I said about
that.
Because
it kind of reaffirms all
yeah.
of the other prior discussions that, you know, he's basically stating the fact. So, what we're saying is,
yeah.
we acquired it before birth, then lost it at birth, and then later by the use of the senses and connection, recovered it.
Yeah. So, and I made a note that we're never learning, merely remembering. So, is this them saying that, like, we never learn anything new, we're just remembering it or, like, being familiarized with it by, like, seeing it, touching it, hearing it, like, everything.
It's almost like, you know, yep, we mentioned in class deja vu and
mm-hmm.
all that, but like an alternate life, you know, with reincarnation and, you know, you're doing something and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, I felt like I've done this before.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if I believe in that or not, though. You know, I mean, I was taught very differently about that, you know, each soul is one soul.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that
yeah.
when that soul is, you know, is within you, that soul goes away,
mm-hmm.
but it doesn't reincarnate, you know, I don't
yeah.
know. It just goes up against what I was taught when I was younger, but it does make me think.
Yeah. One question that I did have, because after they, like, say earlier how, they were just kind of going over it. So, like, yeah, we believe this. We have the knowledge, we lose it, and then we get it back by recollection. It goes into, they ask later at the bottom, when did our souls acquire the knowledge of them? Certainly not since we were born as men. So they're saying, we didn't just get this when we were born as men, so that's saying, did we exist as ourselves before we were in the form of a human? But that makes me question, like, what did we exist as? Just a soul? As something else?
Yeah, they do say something about that, though, about being, you know, depending on your character,
mm-hmm.
you know, how you lived your life, that how the soul lived its life is what it's either going to align itself with some a character of the same.
I remember that.
And it talks about being an animal, like, you know, having an animal as well. Or like being an animal, and then, you know, so it's like, is the soul only bound to human form, human form, human form, human form, but maybe animals or whatever, and depending on your character or who you were, does that make sense?
Yeah. At the top of 115, they agree, this is Socrates saying, so then, Simmias, our souls also existed apart from the body before they took on human form and they had intelligence. My question is, because they're talking about how kind of like you go from life to death and then you go back to life and then back to death. It's kind of like a cycle. When did the cycle start and when does it end? And I think that's
it never says it, though.
Yeah.
It never says how the soul was formed to be in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it never explains or, you know, how it exists, you know, prior to being in the cycle. But it also was funny because even earlier, they just discussed all of that, and he agreed, right?
Yeah.
But a little bit before that, he asks him, which do you choose, that we are born with this knowledge or that we have that we recollect later the things which we had knowledge previously? And then he's like, I have no means of choosing at the moment.
Yeah.
So he's like, at that point, he's like, I still don't know.
Yeah. I guess they agree that even before we were humans, we still had the intelligence. But I guess they never agree on if you're born with it or if you recollect it. But I thought they had been...
They did. Later on, they did come to that, you know, that point. But it seems like they keep wavering. They keep going back and forth. I would assume that's just because of, you know, the nature of arguments and, you know, trying to work it out.
So I think it was on page 115 when we're in, like, 77A and stuff. When they start talking about discussing if they believe if the soul exists after death, and they start talking about how it possibly might just like disintegrate and like go into the air, like like his soul is dispersed and stuff.
This was the first introduction of that, and they go on for page after page after page, trying to figure out what they actually
believe. And talking
about
their different views and stuff. And I put at the bottom of this. I think it's important to note that Socrates chose this conversation and this topic as, like, his last, like, kind of teaching to the people that listen to him and stuff. Because he could have talked about anything, but he's talking about, like, which, I mean, I guess it makes sense because he's about to die, but...
I think he's trying to make them feel better
about
possibly his possible death, you know, because earlier in the text he says that, you know... He had a smile upon his face when thinking of that because he's lived his life right as a philosopher, you know, and that he's going to join the gods.
Yeah.
So I think that he's bringing this up to make them feel better a little bit about what's happening.
I think it's also, like, he wants to share the truth that he knows so that they will also know it and possibly, like, live more right. You know,
but even then, he still allows them to disagree, and he almost...
Yeah.
Agrees with their disagreement at one point. I can't remember what page it was. It was further on, you know, with the argument going back and forth because, you know, you had Sebes believing one way.
Mm-hmm.
Then you had Simmias. Is that how you say
it? That's how I say it.
Yeah, Simmias's view. So, like, one had the view of, you know, it being like the lyre, being harmonious.
Yeah.
Then the other one view...
I think... Like, we'll talk about that when we get there, but also, like, I feel like he allows them to question his view and kind of their own views so that not only does he kind of prove them wrong in a way, I mean, he does, but I guess it's, like, having them put their questions out there about it and kind of their doubts about his view, and then he then again, like, proves it wrong.
Well, it's like the teacher leading you to the correct... know, the correct way, but allowing them to work it out on their own.
Mm-hmm.
I guess kind of like what we're doing right now.
Yeah. Oh, I thought it was kind of funny on page 116, around right above 78, Socrates says, "You seem to have a childish fear that the wind would really dissolve and scatter the soul as it leaves the body, especially if one happens to die in a high wind and not in calm weather." Sieves laughed and said, "Assuming that we are afraid, Socrates, try to change our minds, or rather do not assume that we are afraid, but perhaps this is a child in us who has these fears. Try to persuade him not to fear death like a bogey." "You should," said Socrates, "sing a charm over him every day until you have charmed away his fears." I feel like they're kind of joking in that. I mean, Sieves laughed, so obviously they're kind of joking back and forth. But I think it's kind of funny that even in this really deep conversation that they're having, they're still kind of joking along with it.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, Sieves says, "Where shall we find a good charmer for these fears, Socrates?" he said, "now that you are leaving us." And I think he was kind of joking, but also serious. And Socrates is kind of the person to help like quiet their fears or like rid them of their fears, because he's the one that teaches them and helps them understand why they shouldn't be afraid of certain things. And they're kind of like, well, what are we going to do? And Socrates actually goes on to say, "You must also, like, search, because there's nothing you could spend your money on that could be better than finding, like, these answers and stuff. So search for other people that can have these conversations with you, but also search among yourselves, for you might not easily find people who could do better than this than yourselves." So that was just kind of like a side note in their conversation before they go back into Sieves and Timaeus sharing their different views on it. So I thought that was kind of cool.
Yeah, I had a thought and it just literally just disappeared.
Oh, sorry.
So, it's gone. No, I was just going to say something about that. It's gone. So, anyway, it'll come back. Maybe I will recollect it later.
Okay. So, after that, they go back into their conversation that they're having. They started talking about whether the soul, like, disperses or not, and they started talking about things that are composite and non-composite. So I highlighted one thing at the top of 117. "Are not the things that always remain the same and in the same state most likely not to be composite, whereas those that vary from one time to another and are never the same are composite?" So it goes on to say that, like composite and non-composite, it's visible and the invisible, and the invisible don't really change, the visible does. But I would say that we are, like, our souls change, because I wouldn't say we, but, like, I feel like I'm always changing and growing and learning, but is that just how I feel because I don't really know that maybe that we're just recollecting things and learning things that we already knew? So maybe we're not changing. I'm just contradicting myself at this point.
I don't know. I mean, like I said before, I don't necessarily 100%, you know, believe in the recollection, you know, but they do make a strong case for it.
Yeah.
Somewhat, you know, but I mean, this was, I mean, sort of, it's still relatable, I guess, now, but it was just a long, long, long time ago.
Yeah. But pretty much they keep talking about the visible and invisible. So
they do go back and forth a lot. I mean,
yeah,
a lot. It's like talking the point to death, if you
yeah
will.
Just
not
to
put a pun in there, but
yeah. But yeah, they do end up agreeing on that the visible is kind of like our body and the things that we can sense with our, like, five senses, our hearing and our seeing and our touching and whatnot. But the invisible is our soul, and they say that the invisible doesn't change, so our soul isn't really changing. The body is.
Let's see, I did highlight something on that effect. It says, "Will the soul, the invisible part, which makes its way to a region of the same kind, noble and pure and invisible, to Hades in fact, to the good and wise, God wither? God willing, my soul must soon be going. Will the soul, being of this kind and nature, be scattered and destroyed on leaving the body, as the majority of men say? Far from it, my dear Sieves and Timaeus, but what happens is much more like this. If it is pure when it leaves the body and drags nothing bodily with it, as it had no willing association with the body in life, but avoided it and gathered itself together by itself and always practiced this, which is no other than practicing philosophy in the right way. So it explains how to practice philosophy in the right way. In fact, training to die easily, or is this not training for death? So he states his point again, reiterating the fact again.
Okay, so I made a note to that, and it doesn't really make sense now. I guess so. It's pretty much saying, like, a soul is non-composite when it doesn't hold on to bodily, earthly things. So it's pretty much saying, like, your soul... Now I had a thought, and it kind of left me. But, okay, so it's saying that practicing to die easy, practicing philosophy in the right way, which is practicing, like, training to die easily, is when your body when your soul leaves the body purely, like, not bringing anything else with it. So, that's...
But what is the soul going to be bringing with it? Like, is it the pleasures of the body and man?
Yeah,
or?
I think that's what they mean. Okay, in the next paragraph it says, a soul in this state, which means, like, purely leaving the body without anything, makes its way to the invisible, which is like itself, the divine and immortal and wise, and arriving there it can be happy, having rid itself of confusion, ignorance, fear, violent desires, and the other human ills, and, as it is said of the initiates, truly spend the rest of the time with God. So, my question for that is, like, when you practice dying, and you finally get to, like, is it you're finally getting to a certain point to where you can go spend the rest of your time with the gods? Like, if that means, is it kind of like you have to reach a certain point to not be reborn into another body? I'm kind of confused by that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean...
Like, does it stay with the gods if it has purely left invisible?
I mean, that is if it doesn't regenerate again and again and again in that cycle that you were saying before.
I guess my question is, like, does the cycle ever end? That's just me asking that question again, I guess.
I don't know. I mean, it really, to him, it does end. To Socrates, it does end. The cycle will end in its most purest form, practicing philosophy in the right way. That's when it will end.
Okay.
That's from what I get.
Is what it means. And it's just, they go on to confirm that it's impossible for the body to leave pure and invisible and by itself if you spend your life tied to, like, physical desires of the body. So, desires that your physical body will want, like, I don't even remember what it says.
He talks about it up here where it's like, it is indeed sieves. Moreover, these are not the souls of good, but of inferior men, which are forced to wander there, paying the penalty for their previous bad upbringing. They wander until they're longing for that which accompanies them. The physical, again, imprisons them in the body, and they are then, as is likely, bound to such characters as if they have practiced in life. That's what I was telling you about earlier. Was that, you know, you're bound to those same characters. And it was like, says those, for example, who have carelessly practiced gluttony, violence, drunkenness, are likely to join a company of donkeys or of similar animals. Do you not think so?
So, like, they're pretty much saying if you live your life not practicing philosophy in the right way, you're going to be reborn again into kind of the same state that you left yourself in.
Yeah, joining the same company that you were before. I mean, it even goes down and gives analogies of different types of animals, you know, wolves and hawks, and it goes down to say more. And then...
I think one thing to note at the bottom at C on, no one may join the company of the gods who has not practiced philosophy and is not completely pure when he departs from life.
But he doesn't explain why that this is true.
Well, I guess it's true because you can't join the gods if you're still, if you tie your soul to your body rather than not, then you can't take your body with you to the gods. Like, you can only take your soul purely invisible, clean of any physical wants. So when you, where was it? Because now it made me think of it. How they talked about something about nails and how each time you do something, you nail
your You're nailing your cloak,
soul.
Which is your soul. Like your soul, they made an analogy of it being a cloak. You're nailing that to you. You're nailing it to your
body. Feel like when you like nail your soul to your body, you can't leave it to go to the gods. I think that's kind of him saying why you can't. Yeah. Oh, it's right here. Because every pleasure or pain provides, as it were, another nail to rivet the soul to the body and to weld them together. So, so then that is when Seeds and Samias, I think, because Socrates says, I guess they start questioning it.
Yeah, they did start questioning it very end. It's 84C down at the end.
Okay, yeah, that's, if you're discussing some other subject, I have nothing to say, but if you have some difficulty about this one, do not hesitate to speak for yourself and expound it if you think the argument could be improved. And if you think you will do better, take me along with you in the discussion. So not only is he saying, like, voice your opinion, but he's saying, like, I want to hear it and kind of learn what you think is right. And I think that's really cool how he's still, Socrates, who knows probably a heck of a lot more than they all do, is still yearning to learn more about other people's opinions and views on it to see if maybe his isn't right and he would change his mind. Because I think that's kind of practicing philosophy, is you never really have all the answers, and so you should be learning from other things to see if something else is right.
Questioning, arguing, you know, getting to the points. But
okay, and then it's the next page where Seed starts talking about his harmony thing.
I have it all highlighted there.
So that was his.
So that's his point, and then I.
Yeah, so
Samias is completely different.
Yeah, Steve's point was kind of like a harmony, so where your body is kind of like the instrument, and your soul is the harmony that it makes. So your soul can't survive if this like instrument breaks, if the strings break, you can't make a harmony. So if, like, your body breaks or dies, like, your harmony doesn't go anywhere. So he doesn't, he's saying that he doesn't believe that the souls go anywhere after you die. So then Samias says, I think it does, but only for so often. So he says that you can live in many different bodies, but you shouldn't go into death thinking that you're going to live, because each body that you live in slowly breaks down your soul more and more until finally that last death kills your soul and it doesn't go anywhere else. So that was his, that the soul is long-living and lives longer than just one body, but it's not immortal.
Yeah, I had it highlighted that the soul lasts a long time while the body is weaker and more short-lived. He might say that each soul wears out many bodies.
Yeah, but he's saying you shouldn't think that you're going to live after you die now, because this might be your last body that finally kills your soul. I think that's when Socrates comes back in and tries to prove both of their views wrong, not just so that he's right, but he gives a solid argument to why their views can't be right.
They're contradictory. That's what he's basically saying.
They're saying both of theirs is contradicting what they already said they believed.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I liked something he said on page 129 at 91C, he's saying, if you think that what I say is true, agree with me. If not, oppose it with every argument and take care that in my eagerness, I do not deceive myself and you, and like a bee, leave my sting in you when I go. So the first part kind of is confusing. But the last part of that sentence I think is really cool, where he's saying, like, even when I leave, kind of remember my words and take into consideration with you. think about certain things. Mm-hmm. The next few pages is him talking about how the harmony is contradictive to the similar, to the views that he had already agreed on. There's something else that I'm Oh, Socrates begins talking about how he used to study natural science and how he stopped because it kind of proved things in a more physical way. So he said that like natural science and what he learned about it was saying that
it took his thought processes away.
Yeah.
Like there's an investigative process to science and you know, that investigative process took his thought process away.
Yeah, so he was saying that what he learned from natural science that he didn't agree with was that it's the physical things that controls the choices rather than you, like, your soul deciding to do something. Where was it? So it was saying, like, the bones and the muscles and everything, like, that is why your arm moves. Or that's why you're here, that's why you're there, not because you chose it in your head. So that's something he disagreed on and why he stopped studying natural science and probably why he started focusing more on philosophy. Okay, this was something cool that he said. It's on page 137, 99C. He said, I must be careful to... I must be careful to avoid the experience of those who watch an eclipse of the sun, for some of them ruin their eyes unless they watch its reflection in water or some such material. A similar thought crossed my mind, and I feared that my soul would be altogether blinded if I looked at things with my eyes and tried to grasp them with each of my senses. So I think with that, I highlighted that because I thought that was really cool, was he decided to not try and understand things with his sight and his hearing and smelling and things like that. He decided to instead kind of use his soul and his thoughts to understand that instead of like physically trying to understand something, because that's not what philosophy is. It's
It's about, you know, it's putting all of it on the body. And
yeah.
To the body.
And that's what, well, which he said, blinds him from seeing, like, what's actually there. So I think that was really cool. And it's been, like, 43 minutes.
Yep. I think we're good.
Yep. All right.
Well, we're signing off. We will continue more discussions later.
Yep.
Thank you.